Our God is still on his throne and ruling the affairs of man. Even as he does not change, his truths have not changed. Thankfully, God still has a people which proclaim that old-time religion, setting forth his sovereignty, and the old paths of truth where we can find rest for our souls. Welcome to Word of Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Get your Bible, call your friends, and sit back as we open the King James Scriptures to explore the glorious Word of Sovereign Grace. Here's this week's message.
Thankful for the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Encouraged again to know that God is the high and lofty one that inhabits eternity. He's sitting upon his throne. He's ruling and reigning in the hearts of men. That's good news. I ask that you pray for me for what time I stand before you. I have several things on my mind. I'm not really sure which direction to go or which direction to take. Sister Lorraine had a question this morning that was about the rapture. And what is the rapture? Well, my understanding of what the rapture is completely different than what Tim LaHaye thinks that the rapture is. Tim LaHaye was the author of the Left Behind series. I believe it was Tim LaHaye. He was the author of the Left Behind series and openly admitted that what he was writing was fiction. And if you don't know what fiction is, it means it's not true. Fiction is not true. But my understanding of the rapture is that the dead, and when the Lord comes back, the dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That being caught up, I believe, is what the Word of God would refer to as the rapture. What you have that's become popular in the land today, and even recently, just they made a movie by that title, Left Behind. I actually went and saw it and thought it was pretty weak. I have a habit of examining things from a doctrinal standpoint. And I hear very often from many, says, you got to find something wrong with everything, don't you? Well, I usually do, because there's not much good that comes out of Hollywood. But I would say this, we went and saw the movie War Room this week, and it had me in tears. And don't let anybody tell you Hollywood can't make a decent, wholesome movie, because this one is, and they did. The first time we tried to see it a couple of weeks ago, it was sold out. And then when we got in to see it this time, that place was packed full of people. So there is not all, things are not as bad as the media tries to tell you. There are people that are godly and that are looking for wholesomeness and godly teaching, and are trying to walk in a godly way. But anyway, if you've not seen that movie, I encourage you to see it. I did not pick it apart. Like I say, it had me tearing up a couple of times. I was so thankful to see something that was geared in the right direction. So there's very little of that. Anyway, we're thinking about the Left Behind. What you have here is the 70th week of Daniel taken out of context. And what is popularly taught that at the end of time there will be 7 years of tribulation. There are different takes on or spins on when the church is raptured out. Supposedly when this time of tribulation starts, there's pre-trib, there's mid-trib, and there's post-trib when the church is supposedly taken out. You've got all different kinds of variations on it. But the first thing I'll say is that the 70th week of Daniel was not severed from the other 69. It was fulfilled in succession, and it's a prophecy of the things that the Lord Jesus Christ himself would accomplish, yet it's been so misconstrued and taken out of context, that it ascribes glory to the beast or an antichrist at some future point in time. This was all began by a man by the name of John Darby at about around the 1830s is when he had this visited this young girl who was sick that had a vision of two resurrections. Well, see, that's another thing that this big mess of the transporting the 70th week of Daniel future is it tries to say that there's two resurrections. Well, we know that there's going to be one resurrection of the just and the unjust. There's not going to be two resurrections at the end of time, or one before a thousand-year reign and one after a thousand-year reign. We believe that the Lord is, that thousand-year reign is now. The Lord is reigning today. He's reigning in the hearts of his people. Remember that the scripture says that the kingdom of God is within you, right? And that's where the Lord, wherever there's a kingdom, you have a dominion and you have a king. That's what a kingdom is, a king's dominion. So we have the kingdom of God within us, and we have the Lord who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords that rules and reigns in our hearts. So I could spend a lot of time talking about Daniel chapter 9, verse 27 that speaks of the 70th week. I've actually spoken on that several times in the past. I'm not going to take the time to do that this morning. But I want to encourage you that we have to read the scripture. We have to rightly divide the word of God. And we have to avoid taking a position just because of its popularity. That should be one of our first indications that something is not of God if everybody in the world is going after it. Everybody's following after it. The scripture very plainly tells us that the world cannot receive the spirit of truth. And it doesn't say they will not, it says they cannot. Because they can't see the Lord, they don't understand. It's not until the Lord opens eyes and opens ears and opens hearts until people can begin to see the things of God. I was encouraged to hear of answered prayers that have taken place during the week, and I praise God for it. And I've always thought, if Jesus said you believe that you're going to receive what you ask, and if we don't believe that we're going to receive what we ask, why do we ask? Now, I recognize that sometimes we ask amiss that we might consume it upon our lust. You know, like, Lord, I sure would love to win the lottery. You know, God, let me win the lottery. Well, that's probably one thing that you don't want to pray for that would ruin your life more than likely. I've said this before, that people that have won the lottery, you look back and they've done interviews with these people, and most of them, it totally ruined their lives. Most of them got divorced. Most of them don't have any of the money left. So money is not the answer to your problems. The Lord God is the answer to your problems. And that's why we're to take our problems and lay them at the foot of the cross and leave them there. And he said, cast all your care on him, for he careth for you. So praying to win the lottery is asking amiss. But the Lord says, when you ask, you believe that you receive. And that, indeed, we do ask, believing that we will receive. But I'm reminded that the Lord does answer prayer in his own time, in his own way. A lot of times we see a situation, we think that if we could just rush in with the arm of the flesh, you know, or rush in, throw some money at a problem, or throw some professionals at a problem, that it will rectify. But the fact of the matter is that only God can change a man's heart. We know very well what the scripture says about God taking the stony heart out and putting in a heart of flesh wherein he writes his laws in our hearts and our mind. And only the Lord can prepare the good ground of the heart for when the word of God is sown that it will fall into good ground and bring forth fruit, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. We mentioned very briefly last week about the parable of the sower and how that some fell when the he says the word of God, when it's preached, sometimes it falls on stony ground, or sometimes it falls by the wayside. And he says, and the devil cometh immediately and distracts you from what you just heard so that it can't take any root. Some falls on stony ground, and there's no earth, and it also cannot take root. Some fall among the thorns. He says, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word. Okay, if you're focused on the cares of this world and having worldly riches, that's going to choke out the word, the preached word of God. But then again, he says, some fell into good ground. And that's, we know that only God can prepare the good ground of the heart to receive his word. And I know that every one of us would have a desire to bring forth fruit unto God. Now, notice I said fruit unto God. I did not say fruit unto men, but fruit unto God. And this fruit, I believe, is discernible. First and foremost, by the Lord himself. I know the scripture says, by their fruits ye shall know them. I don't think that we can know them in the sense of who they belong to say that they don't belong to the Lord. We can know them to know who they're serving. I believe that's one of the main thrusts of that text when it says, by their fruits ye shall know them. We can know who men are serving by the fruits that they bring forth. But that fruit of the Spirit, that ninefold fruit of the Spirit, I believe first and foremost is discernible unto God, and that's fruit that's brought forth unto God. So we know that only the Lord can change a man's heart. We can all have had experiences where we've tried to talk to someone about the good things of God, and it's almost like talking to that brick wall over there. They just don't get it. It's not until the Lord does the work that a person's eyes, ears, and heart are open to understand the things of the Lord. And it's a marvelous thing. We call it grace. And we fully understand that. Well, I'm thinking about the prodigal son this morning. That's a text that's found over in Luke chapter 15. I want to pick it up and read that a little bit. And one of the things that I want to tell you that this is not a story about regeneration. I believe that this is speaking of restoration to fellowship. Sometimes in life, you know, we can do a lot to destroy fellowship one with another. And it oftentimes does happen. But something that we cannot do is that we cannot change a relationship. Now, God changed the relationship when he adopted us into his family. But we're his children. We've been adopted into his family. Nothing can change the relationship. But we know that there are things that we can do to damage the fellowship. Over in Luke chapter 15, starting about verse 11, it says, and he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. This is the young man that's saying, I cannot wait to get out from under my father's roof. You know, the strict rules and all the things that I have to do, I have to obey. I hear it all the time. These teenagers say, I can't wait till I turn 18 or till I graduate from high school so that I can get out from under mom and dad's roof and their authority. And this is sort of the thing that we're seeing here, that this young man, he was still the son of his father. That never changes. And that's one of the things that we need to keep in mind as you read this parable. The relationship never changes. But what this young man has done, he's doing things to wreck the fellowship that he has with his father. He says, not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. I think I know a little bit about what riotous living is from firsthand experience. There, at one point in my life, I probably could have written the book on what that was. Now, I'm speaking about things that today that I'm shameful, that I'm ashamed of, that I have done in the past, and how I violated God's just and holy laws. I can't go back and change that. But I do know that it all, at one point, led me to a place where I hit rock bottom. Now, we hear that all the time. You can't get up until you hit rock bottom. And for me, in my experiences, when I was sitting in the Tarrant County Jail, and I made a promise to God, I had hit rock bottom. And I promised the Lord that if you get me out of this situation, I'll try to serve you. And the Lord has kept his end of the bargain. And I've tried to serve, even though as weak and people as I feel my effort to be, nonetheless, I want to serve the Lord with thankfulness and gratitude for how great things that he's done, how that he's delivered me. But I had to hit rock bottom, and I remember after I came back home, and my wife will tell you that my behavior changed drastically. There were some times she was looking for me and couldn't find me, and I was laying between the bed and the wall on my face, begging God for mercy. And you know what? I found that mercy. And I would spend that time also recognizing the fact that God is sovereign over my life. And he can do whatever he desires. I came to the conclusion in my heart that, I can't remember if it's in a song or a scripture somewhere. I think it's in a song, but it says, if my soul were sent to hell, thy righteous law approves it well. I came to grasp with that reality and admitted that to God and was sincere, I believe, if not deceived in my heart. That's why I concluded. And I saw myself deserving of an eternal banishment from the presence of God into the lake of fire. But the Lord delivered me and gave me strength. And this is what I believe that all of God's children have an experience. They're not all like mine. Mine's not all like yours, but we all, the Lord has a way. He knows what it takes. I was like a bucking bronco, okay? And I know the Lord, when he called for that colt to be brought, when he was going to ride into Jerusalem on that triumphant entry, he says that no man had ever sat on it before. Now, you know, if anything about horses, that the first time you sit on a horse, there's some bucking that's going to take place. Well, I bucked for a long time. Well, the Lord said on this particular colt, and it didn't buck. Now, he can do that with an individual if he decides to. But I have some greater lessons to learn. And you know, one of the things that I realized, too, you remember that place where that woman had gone into, I can't remember, it was maybe one of the leaders of the synagogue, and she began to, or the lawyer's house, I can't remember, but she was washing the Lord's feet with her tears and wiping his feet with her hair and anointing his feet with ointment. And it was said that this woman loves much because she was forgiven much. And he says, to whom much is forgiven, the same loveth much. So if a person feels that they've only been forgiven a little bit, they'll only love a little. But I feel like I've been forgiven a great, I've been forgiven much. And I trust that you feel the same way, that you've forgiven much and you love much. But anyway, this young man had gone out and he lived a riotous life. And then Peter says something about that the people that you used to run with, they'll think it strange that you don't, that you now that you want to serve the Lord, you don't want to do the same thing that you did in the past. You don't want to keep the same friends, and they'll mock at you, and they'll think it strange that you don't run with them to the same excess of rioting. I used to live a riotous life, and I think that probably some of you also did in times past too. But our God is gracious and He's good, and I'm thinking of what He said in one place. Was it Isaiah? It said, "I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me." And I believe that Paul brings that forward in the book of Romans and quoting that as well. That saying that when we were living our riotous lives and our wild careers, just like the Apostle Paul was going about his way, but when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by His grace to make His Son manifest. It's God's timing. It's God's timing. But we weren't looking for God. I wasn't looking for the Lord. That it was pretty obvious, but because of some of the things that I was doing and the way that I was living was not God-honoring. But God stopped my wild career, and He can stop anyone else's. He also stopped the Apostle Paul. Paul thought he was doing God service by imprisoning God's people and catching them in prison, and thought he was doing God service when he was standing there watching Stephen being stoned to death. In that sense, Paul was a murderer because he was consenting unto the death of Stephen. And Stephen, following the supreme example of the Lord Jesus Christ, as he was being stoned, he said he saw heaven open and the Son of God standing at the right hand of the throne, and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do." That's what the Lord said when he was on the cross. And Stephen was obviously a blessed individual, but he was preaching in power, in demonstration of the Spirit, and the things that he was saying were cutting them to the heart. There's a difference between being cut to the heart and being pricked in the heart. On the day of Pentecost, when Peter was preaching that marvelous sermon after the people had been speaking in tongues, and they were hearing the glorious works of God proclaimed in their own language, Peter proclaimed that these men were pricked in their hearts, and then cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then the command was given, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." Now, we need to look at that verse, Acts 2:38, very carefully. Some people think that means by getting baptized, you get your sins remitted. No, let's look at it like this. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus means Savior. Christ means anointed. Let's read it like that. Repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of the Savior anointed for the remission of sins. You're doing it in the name of the Savior that was anointed to remit sins. It's by the death of Jesus Christ only that He shed His blood that we can have the remission of sins. Some people say Acts 2:38 sets a precedent or a pattern of how it's always supposed to be done. Well, it's certain. They say that you get baptized and then you receive the Holy Ghost. That's the way that a lot of people of the baptismal regenerationists say that it happens. Well, it didn't happen that way in Cornelius' house. They received the Holy Ghost first, and they were afterward baptized. So, baptismal regeneration, I believe, is a heresy. We're born again by the life-giving voice of the Son of God, and we're baptized in water as a symbol of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And is a public profession to the world and to others that we have put on Christ and that we'll walk in newness of life. But this prodigal son, he had his riotous living. And when, verse 14, and when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Now, I know some people that have had famines in their own lives. There was a famine of the Word of God at one time for 400 years. But he had a famine. There was a famine in that country, or you could have an individual famine in your own personal life. But there was a famine, and he began to be in want. And he joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. This means that he was at a point that he was ready to eat the hog slop. That's basically what being fed to the swine or the pigs or the hogs, whatever you want to say. He was not in a very good place. But then something happened. And when he came to himself, you know, like it says when Samson, all those times when Delilah was trying to find out where his strength lied, that he was asleep, and after he had told her where his strength was, even though he was not telling the truth to her, she said, "The Philistines be upon thee, Samson," and he would shake himself. He would come to himself. Then he would defeat the Philistines except the last time when he had his hair cut. And the reason is because he had a Nazarite vow on him. Now, Samson had some problems. Samson was not very honest. I know I'm deviating or digressing, but Samson was not very honest, and Samson was found to be with a prostitute, and Samson was touched a dead body, which he was not supposed to do, and when he took that honey from the carcass of the lion, and many other things. But anyway, the point of all that is that he would wake up, he would shake himself, and he would come to himself. And this young man, it took him realizing that he was so hungry that he was going to eat the same things that the pigs were eating, that he remembered. He remembered something. And when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger?" And he remembered now how good he had it at home. And I would venture to say that his father was much, much wiser at that point in his life. He was probably remembering all the things that Dad was telling me were true. You'll realize, Asher, once you get older, how wise that your mother and father really are. Right now, you may not agree with everything that they ask you to do, but the day's coming that you will realize it, that they are very wise, and the things that they ask of you is because they love you and they want the best for you. And that's the same way with our Heavenly Father. And God oftentimes suffers us to wander out of the straight and narrow way when we're insistent on walking in our own way. The Lord sometimes suffers that for our own good and for us to realize how good that we truly have it. And we need to recognize how good that we truly have it in the house of God, and the old Baptist having the truth of salvation by grace, knowing that salvation is of the Lord, and that he finished the work that God gave him to do, and that we have the love of God which passes understanding. We are blessed mightily, and we've got it good. Yet I know that in past, or some were thinking that they could find something better out in the denominations of the world. Well, you know, I think one of the things that you find out in the denominations of the world is they have to dress them up like a harlot to attract a young man. They have programs and activities, and they do things and they teach things in there that are not in this book, that are not according to Thus Saith the Lord, that are not in accordance with His commands and precepts. And they have to do that in order to attract people. God forbid that we should ever get in that position. But I'm thankful for the bride of Christ, for the church of the living God, for the old paths and the good way. Doesn't He say, stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths, wherein is a good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. And there are some people that know that the old paths are the right paths. They know that it's the good way. They know they can find rest for their souls, but they say, we will not walk therein. Because they want to be with the crowd. They want to be with the popular. They want to do things their own way instead of doing things God's way. When he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. There it is. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, is what the Lord said. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. They're not going to be filled with the things that the swine would eat, but they're going to be filled with the good things of God. To know and understand that Jesus Christ is their righteousness, and that He is their all in all and everything. That's what we're going to be filled with, the Holy Ghost, according to a measure. Now we know that the scripture says unto Jesus was the Spirit given without measure. And Paul corroborates this when it says, in Christ dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So Jesus had the Spirit without measure, but unto you and I the Spirit is given by measure. The Lord gives you exactly what you need. Exactly what you need. The problem is that we oftentimes ignore and make that our last option, to look to ask for the guidance of the Holy Spirit or to ask the God's leadership. That's the last thing that we sometimes do. And that should be the very first thing that we do, is look, ask for the leadership of the Holy Spirit and humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God and admit that we've sinned against God and against His laws, and we've sinned against our brothers and their sisters, our husbands, our wives. But that's what this man did. I've sinned, and I will go to my father. And first he said, I will arise. Now, what do you think he was? That he had to arise. Maybe he was flat on his face in between a bed and a wall. Or he was flat on his face in a ditch. And he realized when he was praying, he came to himself. He said, I will arise and go to my father and say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. You know, had he decided, well, things are pretty rough here, I'm going to go back home, and I'm going to tell Dad that I really deserve to be, you know, you let me back in the house. I really deserve all these things. I have a right to be here. That's not the attitude that he had. He says, I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. This man had a contrite spirit. He had a broken heart. And God can heal those broken hearts. There's a scripture that talks about falling on a rock or a stone. He says, on some that rock would fall on them and grind them to powder. with others, others would fall on that rock and be broken. That is a good thing. That is what happened to this young man. He fell upon the rock and he was broken, and he realized that he could not fix himself. But having that rock fall on you and grinding you to powder is a very different situation. So pray to God that every one of us fall on the rock and become broken. Come to the end of self, and we reach out to the true and the living God, recognizing that our strength is made, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness, and recognizing our weakness and our inability. I pray that every one of us fall upon that rock and are broken, and that we look to the Lord in a true and a living way, not giving God lip service. You know, some people, the Lord says, they honor me with their mouths and with their lips. He said, but their hearts are far from me. And I don't believe that any of us are like that. I pray that we're not. But God knows the difference. He sees our hearts. So, I will arise and go to my father and say unto him, I've sinned against heaven before thee, no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Now he's ready to serve. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Now they're beginning to rejoice. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Now, I remember an experience where I was trying to relate something similar to some people that when I belonged to another order, and they thought I just needed some rededication. They thought I just needed some counseling. They didn't recognize that I was having an experience of grace. And that's what we, one of the things that we're seeing here, this son is recognizing grace. No worthy to be called thy son, but the father said to his servant, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and make merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they begin to make merry. Now, what was he dead? What was he dead to? He wasn't dead in trespasses and sins. He was dead to the fellowship of his father. Or he was dead to the fellowship. He wasn't dead in trespasses and sin. I'd like to say, I don't believe that this is a story of regeneration, but one of conversion and restoration of fellowship. Okay? He was lost and is found, and they began to make merry. What if the scripture says that the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner that repenteth? It's time to rejoice. Now the other son, he's trying to figure out what it is that's going on, and this is a lesson for us. Now his elder son was in the field, and he came and drew nigh to the house, and he heard the music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, my brother is come. And thy father had killed the fatted calf because he had received him safe and sound. And he was angry. That's sort of like, I'll think about the parable of the hired servants. Remember, the Lord hired some servants to come and work in the vineyard at the first part of the day, and they all agreed for a penny, and even up to the 11th hour, and then they all received a penny, and he paid the last ones first. And the ones that had borne the heat and the burden of the day became angry because they thought they should have received more. But they all agreed to work for that penny. Anyway, that kind of ties into this a little bit. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore, his father came out. He was standing without. He didn't want to go in and rejoice. He didn't think that it was needful. And his father came out and entreated him, and he answered him and said to his father, lo, these many years I do serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as thy son was come, who hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed the fatted calf for him. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. This is the lesson for us today, that God is with us, and all that he has is ours. Does he not say, But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory? He says, it was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again. Notice, alive again. I can't go to California again because I've never been to California. I could go to New York again because I've been to New York, but I've never been to California. So, and this one, he was dead and is alive again. That's one of the things that tells us that this is talking about restoration of fellowship and conversion. And was lost and is found. So, God's people today, we can call upon the Lord. We have the privilege to pray directly to him. He says, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is a propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also the sins of the whole world. Now, I don't want to go into that. You know that we can explain what that whole world means, and it's not talking about all of Adam without exception, all of the seed of Adam. But he is a propitiation for our sins. He satisfied our sin debt in the presence of the Father, and he is our advocate. He is the one, our lawyer, if you will. That's what an advocate is, or a mediator, or someone that pleads our cause with God. And we can come before him. And even if we be like that woman that went before the unjust judge and continually says, avenge me of my adversary, and he would not. And she wore him out. And he got to the point where she says, though I fear not God nor man, this woman continually coming makes me weary. So she went. So he avenged her of her adversary. If you see what the unjust judge did, how much more shall God answer his elect, which cry unto him day and night? Yes, cry out unto the Lord. He will avenge. He will answer your prayer. He will give you that which you stand in need of. You're of much value in the sight of the Lord, even though we're not to exalt ourselves and we see ourselves as unworthy of the least of his blessings. Each and every one of God's children are valuable. He talks about the sparrows. Not a sparrow falls to the ground without your father, without God. I had a very strange thought yesterday. I was getting my hair cut, and as my hair was being cut, I thought about that scripture that says, he knows the very hairs, the number of the hairs on your head. And okay, so as the barber took, or the lady that was cutting my hair, took a swipe with the barber clippers, and I thought, does he know how many I have now? And as she took another one, is he still counting? And you know, and I said to myself, I believe that he knows. That he knows. I believe that he knows. I don't know anything else to add to that, but yes, that he knows. But you're valuable in God's sight. The very hairs of your head are numbered. And he says, a sparrow doesn't fall to the ground without you notice. And he says, you're of much more value than many sparrows. Much more value than many sparrows. You're valuable enough that he loved you to die for you in your room and in your stead, taking the punishment that you deserved. That's how much you're worth. You're worth the life and the love of the God of glory. What a wonderful blessing it is to think about that. But all things that he told that second son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. We don't have to wander away from the church to hit rock bottom to figure that out. To understand that we serve the God of glory, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the one that breathed the breath of life into Adam's nostrils, he became a living soul, and that he's created all things through Jesus Christ. And this is the God that we serve that can speak, and it is done. That's the God that we serve. And we have the privilege that we can pray to Him. And as I said early on, if we don't believe that God is going to answer our prayer, don't even bother. But believe, when you pray, you pray believing that you're going to receive the thing that you ask, except that you ask amiss to consume it upon your lust. Believe that you're going to receive it, and it will come to pass. Our God is good. Our God is gracious. He's kind. He's loving. He's compassionate. He's merciful. If we only had the words to express how we feel about the greatness and the grandeur of this God that we attempt to serve. He's given us all things, and the scripture says, in Him we live and move and have our being. Without Him, brothers and sisters, we're nothing. Without Him, we're nothing. And let's give Him the glory, the honor, and the praise for prayers that are answered. And we thank Him for His kindness and His goodness. He is God, and there's none beside Him, and He can do whatever He wants. I thank you all for your good attention as we stand and sing a suitable hymn. There's one more here has the desire, you know, this morning to speak our prayer.
Word of Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Paradise Primitive Baptist Church is located at 5300 Mansfield Road in Arlington, Texas. Services begin at 10:30 each Sunday morning. Plan to come and worship with us. To find out more about Paradise Primitive Baptist Church, visit www.paradisepbc.org. Be sure to visit our website for articles, video, and audio sermons, as well as biblical answers to your questions. Thanks for watching, and be sure to join us again next week. May God richly bless you.